Hello, do you see my screen?
Yes, we see.
I will give a talk titled Surgical Approach to Thalamus in Relation to the White Matter Tracts of the Cerebrum. I would like to thank Professor Necmettin Pamir and Dr. Baran Bozkurt for this kind invitation. And also I want to thank Professor Başkaya for nice words to our study. Before talking about surgical approach to the thalamus, I would like to talk about boundaries of thalamus in a few sentences. Thalamus is a pair of egg-shaped gray matter mass deep in the white matter that is located in between the lateral ventricles medially and the internal capsule laterally. The first picture, the massa intermedia interconnected both thalami through the third ventricle. Thalamus has different parts that face the body of lateral ventricle, atrium, and the temporal horn. Upper section of lateral walls of third ventricle is formed by two thalami on each side. Thalamus is located deep in the lower half of the precentral and postventral gyrus and in the posterior half of insula. The bed nucleus of striatum terminalis forms the anterior border of thalamus. Lateral border of thalamus is formed by internal capsule. Its posterior border is defined by atrium and quadrigeminal cistern. Hypothalamus is located inferior to the anterior part of thalamus. Subthalamic nucleus is located inferiorly to the thalamus. The superior colliculus and tectum are located inferior to the posterior part of thalamus. Optic tract lies inferolaterally to the anterior half of the thalamus and ends into the lateral geniculate body. Fornix extends toward to the superior thalamus, starting from the anteromedial aspect of the thalamus. Choroidal fissure is a C-shaped fissure found between thalamus and fornix. In our study, a modified thalamus classification proposed by Ranger, Castilla, and Spassler was used. Thalamus was divided into six regions and four subregions. Region 1 is anteroinferior thalamus, region 2 medial thalamus, region 3 lateral thalamus, region 4 posterior superior thalamus, region 5 lateral posterior inferior thalamus, and region 6 is medial posterior inferior thalamus. Pulvinar thalami were divided into three parts as region 4, 5, and 6. Region 1 consists of the lateral anterior nucleus and inferior anterior nucleus, and it's located anterior inferiorly within the thalamus. For reaching region 1, we have used suprachoroidal infrafrontal approach and interhemispheric transrostral translaminar terminalis approach. For transrostral approach, resection of rostrum leads to injury in callosal fibers and related neurologic deficit is frontal disconnection syndrome. Uncinate fascicle, diagonal band of Broca, substantia innominata, and anterior commissure are in risk of damage in suprachoroidal infrafrontal approach. And predicted neurologic deficits related to suprachoroidal infrafrontal approach is psychiatric disorders. In first picture, after dissection of the Sylvian fissure, the olfactory nerve, suprachoroidal triangle, and M1 and A1 are exposed. This approach requires the identification of the medial orbital gyrus. A cortical incision is made lateral to the olfactory nerve toward the posterior aspect of the medial orbital gyrus. After the cortical incision, perforating arteries are identified and mobilized to get an adequate surgical corridor. The resultant surgical corridor is further deepened to reach the anterior thalamus. As I mentioned before, uncinate fascicle, diagonal band of Broca, substantia innominata, and anterior commissure are in risk of damage in suprachoroidal infrafrontal approach. The most important disadvantage of this approach is the associated high risk of injury to the perforating arteries that may lead to internal capsule stroke. And the other approach for region 1 is interhemispheric transrostral translaminar terminalis approach. This approach is a suitable technique to access the lesions located in the medial part of the anterior inferior thalamus. After identifying rostrum, lamina terminalis, A1's perforating arteries, and the anterior communicating artery, this approach needs an incision to the rostrum and lamina terminalis. Anterior commissure, massa intermedia, and third ventricle can be exposed. The medial anterior inferior thalamus is reached just posterior to the foramen of Monro and in the vicinity of the choroidal plexus. In this approach, resection of rostrum leads to injury in callosal fibers. Region 2 consists of the superior anterior, medial, and centromedial nuclei and is located medially within the thalamus. Region 2 was divided into two following subsections using the choroidal fissure as the anatomical reference point: lateral ventricular part of region 2 and third ventricular part of region 2. The anterior, lateral, and medial borders of region 2 were defined by the thalamus right vein, internal medullary lamina, and the superior choroidal vein, foramen of Monro and the choroidal plexus respectively. For reaching region 2, we have used the anterior interhemispheric transcallosal approach. In the anterior interhemispheric transcallosal approach, the callosal fibers are severed since the body of corpus callosum is passed through. And a predicted neurologic deficit related to this approach is frontal disconnection syndrome. In this approach, care should be taken to avoid injury to the cortical bridging veins, pericallosal arteries, calloso marginal arteries, and the geno and the body of the corpus callosum should be identified. After the body of the lateral ventricle is accessed, several structures, including the fornix, choroidal fissure, lateral ventricular part of the medial thalamus, and the caudate nucleus can be seen. After opening the choroidal fissure, the part of the medial thalamus forming the lateral wall of the third ventricle and internal cerebral veins become visible. Also in this approach, the callosal fibers are severed since the body of corpus callosum is passed through. This region is located laterally within the thalamus and contains the ventral anterior, ventral lateral, ventral posterior, lateral dorsal, and lateral posterior nuclei. For reaching region 3, we have used contralateral interhemispheric transcallosal approach. In this approach, the callosal fibers are severed. And also, related neurologic deficits from frontal disconnection syndrome. With the contralateral approach, a more feasible angle and exposure is achieved for the lateral thalamus. The closed adjacency of the internal capsule just lateral to the thalamus should be borne in mind and care should be taken during the removal of lateral thalamic lesions. In this approach, as I mentioned before, the callosal fibers are severed. Region 4 is located posterior superiorly within the thalamus. Its superior, lateral, and anterior borders are defined by the lateral ventricle, posterior limb of the internal capsule, and region 2 and 3, respectively. Also, it is divided into two following regions using the choroidal fissure as an anatomical reference point: lateral ventricular part of region 4, region 4A, and cisternal part of region 4, region 4B. Region 4 forms the pulvinar thalamus together with region 5 and 6. For reaching region 4, we have used occipital interhemispheric transcallosal approach, distal sylvian approach, transpericuneus approach, and superior parietal lobule approach. Occipital interhemispheric transcallosal approach requires forceps major damage, and related neurologic deficits are auditory and visual disconnection syndromes. In distal sylvian approach, arcuate fascicle, middle longitudinal fascicle, posterior part of claustrocortical fibers and coronaradiata, retro lenticular internal capsule, and the tapetum are at risk. And related neurologic deficits in this approach are language and auditory disorders and motor weakness. In the transpecuneus approach, SLF1, callosal fibers and cingulum are at risk. Related neurologic deficits are memory disturbance, visual hallucinations, and behavioral changes. In the superior parietal lobule approach, SLF1, 2, and tapetum are at risk. Predictive neurologic deficits are spatial hemineg neglect and Gerstmann syndrome. Occipital interhemispheric approach allows access to the posterior superior aspects of the thalamus. Following the line of precuneus, cuneus, and parieto-occipital sulcus, the splenium of the corpus callosum is reached under the inferior sagittal sinus. After splenium incision, the atrium of the lateral ventricle is reached and cruciformis can be visualized. After entering into the ventricle, the bulbus of cavernous corpus callosum and calcareus can be seen medially, while region 4A and the choroidal plexus can be observed in anterior wall. After opening the choroidal fissure in the picture 3, region 4B is reached. The disadvantages of this approach include the requirement for considerable splenial resection and visual deficits due to retraction of visual cortex around the calcarean sulcus. This approach requires the incision of callosal fibers originating from the splenium. Transpecuneus approach allows reaching to the posterior superior part of thalamus. After a cortical incision in the precuneus, atrium is accessed with deeper exploration. After entry into the atrium, the lateral ventricular part of region 4, choroidal plexus, stria terminalis, and the fornix should be visualized in the opposite wall. Opening of the choroidal fissure allows access to region 4B. In the transpecuneus approach, SLF1, callosal fibers and cingulum are at risk. In superior parietal lobule approach, a cortical incision is made at least 1 centimeter posterior to the postfrontal gyrus, and the incision may be extended up to the level of the parieto-occipital sulcus. This approach allows access to the body atrium junction of the lateral ventricle. After access into the entry via the superior parietal lobule approach, the main guidance is provided by the choroidal plexus. In this approach, SLF1, SLF2, and tapetum are at risk. In distal Sylvian approach, a wide opening is provided for the Sylvian fissure. The posterior point of insular cortex and the posterior medial aspect of the Heschel gyrus define the posterior insular point. A cortical incision is made at this point, and the resultant surgical corridor is deepened to reach posterior body of the lateral ventricle and atrium. The two anatomical landmarks landing guidance for the surgeon are represented by choroidal plexus and the cruciformis. In this approach, arcuate fascicle, middle longitudinal fascicle, posterior part of claustrocortical fibers and corona radiata, retrolenticular internal capsule, and tapetum are at risk. Region 5 is located laterally and posteriorly inferiorly within the thalamus and projects to the anterior wall of the atrium. Its anterior border is formed by region 2 and 3, while the lateral border is formed by the internal capsule and choroid nucleus. Medially, its neighborhoods include region 6 and inferiorly the midbrain. The lateral geniculate body where optic tracts and optic radiation immerse is located in this region. For reaching region 5, we have used subtemporal approach and paramedian supracerebellar transcentorial approach. Paramedian supracerebellar transcentorial approach requires cingulum and fornix damage. And neurological deficits related with this approach, behavioral and cognitive change and memory disturbance. The lateral posterior inferior aspect of the thalamus can be accessed via this approach, which is particularly advantageous for in reaching the thalamomesencephalic junction and the lateral geniculate body. Through following the sulcus line, lateral geniculate body may be reached. There is no need for white matter incision unless temporal resection is required. The retraction of temporal lobe can damage optic radiation and can be result visual deficits. Paramedian supracerebellar transtentorial approach allows access the lateral posterior inferior thalamus. After tentorial incision, the parahippocampal gyrus, collateral sulcus, pineal gland, and the superior and inferior colliculi are identified. The posterior limit of parahippocampal gyrus resection to protect the visual cortex is defined by the inferior colliculus. After resection, the pulvinar thalami, fornix, temporal horn, and the choroidal plexus should be visible. After incision of the fornix, the lateral geniculate body becomes visible. This approach requires cingulum and fornix damage. The last region is region 6. Region 6 is located medially and posterior inferiorly within the thalamus. Its anterior border is defined by region 2 and 3 and lateral border by region 5. Midbrain lies inferiorly to region 6. In its close medical vicinity lie the lateral habenular nucleus, habenular commissure, and the pineal gland. Region 6 projects to the wing of the ambient cistern. The medial geniculate body is located in this region. For reaching region 6, we have used supracerebellar infratentorial approach and suboccipital transtentorial approach. White matter incision is not performed in this surgical approach. This approach, supracerebellar infratentorial approach, allows access to the medial posterior inferior aspect of the thalamus. There are several variations for this approach, median, paramedian, and lateral. After opening the quadrigeminal cistern, the branches of the superior cerebellar artery, P3s, the vein of Galen, internal cerebral veins, internal occipital vein, basal vein of Rosenthal, pineal gland, and the fourth cranial nerve are visible while reaching the medial posterior inferior thalamus. Care must be taken to avoid injury to the posterior medial choroidal artery. As I mentioned before, there is no need for white matter incision in this approach. The last approach is suboccipital transtentorial approach. This approach allows access to the medial posterior inferior aspect of the thalamus. The dotted line shows the tentorial incision area. After tentorial incision and opening of the quadrigeminal cistern, splenium, vein of Galen, internal cerebral vein, internal occipital vein, basal vein, P3 and fourth cranial nerve and superior and inferior colliculi are visible. Medial posterior inferior thalamus should be visible lateral to the pineal gland and inferolateral to the splenium. As in the another approach, white matter incision is not required in this approach. Neurosurgeons should be familiar with the structure and anatomy of the thalamus, as well as with its association to other surrounding neurovascular structures, in addition to having a good level of knowledge on pros and cons of each surgical approach for thalamic lesions to make well-informed decisions for the appropriate surgical technique and to improve safety of interventions. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.